bedtime. Good morning and good night. Well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our international night. This time of year, we always host this event, and it's going to be an absolute treat tonight and a pleasure for us to be able to bring it to you. We're about to begin, and so if you could please find your seats. We might have already mentioned, but for those who have just arrived, all saved seats are now need to be given up. And to help our host teams, what we'd love it if you could do is if there's a spare seat next to you, can you please move in towards the center of your section of seating to leave those spare seats on the outside of the aisle? That would greatly help our host team. You're welcome tonight to use flash photography and to sit back, relax, enjoy it, and to join in. This is our gift to you. This is Calvary's International Night.
Jesus told his 12 disciples, "Go into all the world and preach the good news." To those listening, it must have sounded like madness. After all, Jesus was born in a rural backwards town from which he never traveled further than 300 kilometers. His enemies dismissed him as a local teacher. He was born in obscurity and they were certain would disappear into obscurity. But instead, the Christian faith spread like fire from Israel to across the globe, winning the hearts and minds of people from every place and every culture. The Apostle John, in his vision of heaven, said he saw a great multitude which no one could count from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne. And he heard the angels in heaven worshiping Jesus, singing, "With your blood you purchased people from every tribe and language and nation." The nations belong to God. He created them. He loves them. He died for them. He will redeem them. That God created the nations and that Jesus loves them is the basis of our belief that every culture has unique ways of reflecting the greatness and creativity of our God and is therefore worthy of respect and celebration. That God created the nations and that Jesus came to save people from each of them is the basis of our commitment to being a church that is inclusive rather than exclusive, that is open rather than closed, that is united without being uniform, that has one spirit whilst being able to celebrate and enjoy many styles. Townsville is a city of many cultures, and Calvary reflects that. The people that comprise our church come from Papua New Guinea, the islands of Fiji, India, the Philippines, New Zealand, Colombia, Kenya, Ethiopia, Rwanda, Congo, South Africa, Zimbabwe, Uganda, Sierra Leone, and the United States of America. We have families from Hungary, Bulgaria, Holland, Scotland, England, Greece, Egypt, Malaysia, the Solomon Islands, China, Canada, Italy, India, and they are just some of the countries we are aware of. We all look different, dress different, dance different, eat different, sound different, and cheer for different teams when the Olympic Games or Soccer World Cups roll around. But every Sunday we come together to celebrate and elevate the God who made us, the God who died for us, and the God who one day will take us to be with him forever and ever. His name is Jesus. He is the God of the African, the Islander, the European, the Asian, and the American. He is the God of the black man, the white man, and every color in between man. God is not an Aussie, but he loves Aussies. He is not an American, but he loves them. He's not an African, but boy did he do some of his best work when he created the continent of Africa. He's not Asian, but the Asians move his heart. He's not European or Islander, but the European and Islander nations are ever so dear to him. The nations at their best reflect his glory, and when the nations are reflecting his glory, they are at their best. Tonight, we celebrate the glory of our God as reflected in the nations of the world that comprise Calvary Christian Church.
Welcome tonight to our annual International Night. We want to take this opportunity to welcome you, and it's our privilege to be able to host you. We want to welcome, especially tonight, Councillor Tony Parsons, who's here with us. Would you please put your hands together for Councillor Tony Parsons? And also the head of the Cultural Centre, Dr. Favridin Deliri. Would you please put your hands together for him as well tonight? Well, my name's Daniel, and this is Miriam, and tonight it's our pleasure to be your hosts. Just a couple of things for you to be aware of tonight. If you would like to be able to check your before school age children into a kids program, there is one that's running tonight for 18-month-year-olds right through to 5-year-olds. If you go out into the foyer in our creche area, there's a program that's going to run throughout the night that you're welcome to check your kids in for that. If you've got primary school age kids and they didn't receive one of the kids packs on the way in, you can go out to the foyer and find one of those kids packs for primary school age kids as well. The other thing we'd like to let you know about is that the toilets are located out in the foyer. If you head out to the foyer, you'll see that the ladies are on the right and that the gents are on the left. There's also a disabled toilet that's in the foyer as well. If there's any other questions or anything else that would help to make your night a great success, then you can ask one of the people in the Here to Help You shirts. They're a part of our hosting team, and they will make sure that you have a great night tonight.
As we move from nation to nation, tonight, we are just not going to celebrate the richness and beauty of the cultures, but also highlight the history of the gospel in each place and people group.
Well, we began tonight with Brazil, and that was Matt and the team from Capoeira Brazil. Would you put your hands together for those guys? Capoeira is a traditional form of fighting that incorporates dance in Brazil, and as we continue in the country of Brazil, we're going to begin by interviewing one of the great young Brazilian girls who's a part of our church. Her name is Carla. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please put your hands together for her?
You've got a bit of a fan club out there, Carla. So, Carla, you're from Brazil. What part of Brazil are you from?
I'm from the northeast of Brazil.
I like your accent already. It's the north of Brazil. What city?
My city is Recife.
Okay, we're all experts on Brazil after the World Cup. You know this.
Yes.
When did you arrive in Australia?
I arrived in the last year, in July of the last year.
To do university?
Yes, to do university.
What are you studying?
I study marine biology.
Very good. And why study that in Townsville?
Because we did like an exchange, so the JCU chose me with my Brazilian university in Brazil.
Okay. Now, how did you end up coming to Calvary Church once you got to Townsville?
So, the owners of my house here, they are from here, is Jill and Guy. They work here in Calvary School. And they told me about the church. And I have two boys. They were my neighbors, Nick and Royce. They're from Singapore. They are already gone. Mm-hmm. But they were
coming to Calvary too, weren't
they? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I asked for them if I could come with them to see how is the church and young people, because I heard that was really cool. So I came to with them. To
you were
see.
Looking for a boyfriend, weren't you?
Oh, yeah.
So, what do you think of Aussie guys? Do you like Aussie guys?
Oh, man. Stop it. Don't do this.
All right, so, were you going to church in Brazil?
Yes, I'm going to some church there.
Tell us about church in Brazil. How's it different?
It's different for the case that we don't have like so much technology as you have here. But my church is big as well. It's Anglican Church in Brazil. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's pretty much like the same, but it's not so, I don't know, so exciting like here.
So you are going to sing for us, is that right?
What? Repeat.
I'm just telling you that you are going to sing for us. Are you going to sing a song
yes,
for us?
Yes, yes, I'm going to sing.
That is such a relief for both of us.
Yes. Sorry. Sorry.
What are you going to sing for us?
I'm going to sing Hosanna from his song United.
And are you going to sing it in English or?
No, I'm going to sing in Portuguese.
In Portuguese?
Okay. Yes.
Well, why don't you give Carla a great round of applause as she performs Hosanna in Portuguese.
Thank you.
Good on you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Carla and her friend Carla, and accompanying them on the keys was Kate. Well, we're going to stay on the continent of South America and move from Brazil to Colombia. Did you know almost 97% of Colombian population identify themselves as Christian? And much of this statistic represents the strong cultural connection that Colombians have with the Roman Catholic Church.
A nation that has been consistently destabilized by left-wing guerrilla groups, Colombia spent much of the 20th century struggling to stabilize its internal politics. This political instability has meant that the safety of evangelical Christians has been at risk. More than 150 Protestant pastors have been martyred since 2000, and many Roman Catholic priests and lay workers have also been murdered by armed groups.
Due to persecution, many evangelical Christians choose not to identify themselves on official surveys. Yet anecdotal evidence suggests a significant surge in the growth of Pentecostal churches in Colombia in the 21st century.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me as we welcome Isabella Agudelo singing 10,000 Reasons in Spanish.
God bless.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was Daniel and Louise. And before that, that was Angela Argadello, who's 11 years old, singing 10,000 Reasons. Will you please put your hands together for all of our Colombian performers? We're now going to trek to another part of the world, to the continent of Africa.
As a continent, Africa has a rich history of responding to the gospel. Nation upon nation have responded to the call of God, reaching right back to the Queen of Sheba, who traveled from Ethiopia to King Solomon's court in the Old Testament.
In Africa, the church is on fire. It's the first continent to become majority Christian, over 50% in a single century. Yale historians state that African Christianity is not just a curious phenomenon in an obscure part of the world, but that African Christianity might in fact be the shape of things to come.
You might be interested to know that Africa has over 2,000 languages represented. And just today, we are going to listen to just about 8 of them as our beautiful Africans take us through the reading of the word.
The scripture that we're going to read tonight is from Acts 17, verse 26 and 27. In English, it reads, "And he made of one of every nation of men to dwell on all the faces of the earth, having determined their appointed season and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek God, if happily they might feel after him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us."
My name is Andrew Thieno. I'm reading from a language called Jofadola from Uganda. Thank you. Wokwongdano achiel, gochweyo nonin je, tomiyo jobedo ipinjipi, gowanamu chango chano chong, dirko di keo makabedo, majidio bedie, otimwa ameno ni, jowanyali rango go, Nipo idi jo nwango go, munyo jo muda muda jo rango go. To iadieri, were kinitie bori, ginya toro je, kwongwan. Thank you.
My name is Michelle Chokuda and I'm originally from Zimbabwe. I'll be reading this Bible verse in Shona. Mabasava postori 17, ndima zimukati, 26 kushika 27. Kuva pamunhu mumwe chete akaita ndudzi dzose dzavanhu kuti vagare panyika yose uye akavatarira nguva nenzvimbo dzavo chaidzo dzavangagara. Mwari akaita izvi kuitira kuti vanhu vagomutsvaka, kuti zvimwe vangamuwana, kunyange zvake asiri kure nomwe nomwe wedu. Amen.
I'm Rema, and I'm reading from Ghana in Chi. Yam Babun Chachan Yafafi, a smartphone sum, a 2 day son. On them on your papa, Kusun or Bonny Penny, they are better as I see so. Neighbor should share in Briar the better at Temu Denumu. On them, sir, on your coupon Benhen, now so also on your pa Yachibeno. Amen.
My name is Maria Joleyemi. I'm from Nigeria, and I will be reading in Yoruba. O City Fier Jacono. Da bobori le ede lati tedo si oju abaye o siti pinu akoko ti ayan tele ati ala ebi bu won ki won ki ole mawa oluwa boya bi okan won bale fasi ti won siri bi o ti le sepe ko jina si olukulukuwa. Amen.
My name is Chinelo Aganwa, and I'm also from Nigeria, and I'll be reading in Igbo. O sinofu Onye weke madu niene, oma oge fage kuni, malu oge fagada, oma ebe fagelu, ocho kamadu niene, chonya ebe ono eteroaka. Amen.
My name is Yamanya Mtawale, and I'm from Zambia, and I'll be reading in Bemba. Emili moya batumwa, 17 verse 26 and 27. Ukufuma kumuntu umwa, lesa pangle abantu abalekana lekana, nokwa wika munchendeshon sepano chalo. Lesa chitile fipak tu mundu ale fwaisha lesa na kalimo kutiba msanga. Lesa okupitila pafyo ba mfapali leso mwine. Amen.
My name is Marty Engelbrecht. I'm originally from South Africa, and I will read in Afrikaans. Handelinge 17 vers 26 en 27. En hy het uit een bloed al die nasies van die mensdom gemaak om oor die hele aarde te woon, terwyl hy vooraf bepaalde tye en die grense van hulle woonplek vasgestel het, sodat hulle die Here kon soek of hulle hom miskien kon aanraak en vind, al is hy nie ver van elkeen van ons nie.
My name is Nancy. I am reading from Swahili. My name is Nancy. I'm reading from Kenya, Swahili language. Matendo ya mitume sura ya 17 mstari wa 26 hadi 27 yasema hivi: kutokana na mtu mmoja aliumba mataifa yote na kuyawezesha kuishi duniani kote. Aliamua na kupanga kabla kabisa lini na wapi mataifa yangeishi. Alifanya hivyo ili mataifa hayo yapate kumfuata, na kama vile kwa kupapasa papasa yapate kumfikia. Hata hivyo lakini, Mungu hayuko mbali na kila mmoja wetu. Amina.
Oh!
us. We'll love you, we'll love you, we'll love you, Lord. Yeah,
yeah. Emmanuel.
Come and put those hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah.
a shout out if you wish you were African right about now. Come on. I'm claiming it because I'm the mother of two Ethiopians, so I figure I'm black on the inside. I got my white chocolate going on. Well, if you are visiting here at Calvary, we want to give you a massive Calvary welcome. My name is Sam McPherson. My husband is James. He's the good looker over there in the suit. And we are the senior pastors of Calvary Christian Church. And nights like tonight is where we get to bring community inside our house and show you a little bit about what Calvary is as a church family. And we are so glad that you are here. And so what we'd love to do is this. We've got some beautiful girls standing in the aisles and they're holding these welcome packs. And we would love to get one into your hands. What the packs contain is they've got information about our church, some refreshments, some chockies and some water, but just our way of saying a little present just to say welcome to our house. And we'd love to give those to you just to make you feel welcome. So if you are visiting here at Calvary tonight and you love one of those packs, I'm going to get the girls to walk down the aisle right now and just throw your hand in the air, give them a quick wave, and they'll pop one of those into your hands right now. Fantastic. They will get to you eventually. Nights like this, we have a lot of visitors, but we've got plenty of packs, so hold on and they'll get to you very, very soon. Now, if perchance the girls don't actually get to you or they run out of packs, at the end of the night, just jump to our information desk in the foyer and they can pop one of these in your hand. Now, you'll notice on the outside of this pack, there is a card and a pen. Now, if you are visiting Calvary and you would love to get in touch with us and just find out a little bit more about church, about why we do what we do in community here in Townsville, and you'd love us to give you a call and just catch up and work out how we could possibly serve you, please feel free to fill that card in. And in a moment, our offering receptacles are going to be passing through. You can pop it in the bucket and we will give you a buzz during the week, which will be very cool. Awesome. Now, we're going to have a look at church news in just a moment, which is going to give you a little bit of a taste of what we do here at Calvary. While church news is playing, we're actually going to be taking up our offering. Now, that's for our church, Calvary family, to give their tithes and offerings as we do every Sunday. And if you're visiting, please do not feel obliged to do that. That's for our family, and the buckets will be passing along your aisle. Just pass it through while we watch church news. Check out the big screens.
In concert.
On September 14th is our next water baptism party. Come along on this night to celebrate the difference Jesus has made in people's lives. If water baptism is your next step, then you can sign up at the Next Steps desk today. Calvary Women's present Nourish, a night with Jane Grover. Jane Grover is a qualified chef and author of the best-selling book, Naked Food. She's passionate about food that tastes great and is good for you, focusing on organic and locally sourced food.
If you do something gradually, it is sustained. If you do something fad, it'll only last till the next fad.
Don't miss loads of taste testing, great music and a great night out. Book in at the info desk or online. Sunday, September 7th is Father's Day and we're celebrating dads. Be here for funny videos, prize giveaways and more. That's Father's Day here at Calvary. On Wednesday night, the 3rd of September, is our Creative Arts Family Dinner. Come along to meet the team and find your place as a muso, singer, production team and more. Here at church, 7 o'clock, Wednesday, the 3rd of September.
Well, you'll find more information about all of those events in the Calvary newsletter that's actually located on the chair that's just in front of you. And if tonight you were, this is your first time at Calvary, or perhaps your first time in a little while, and you didn't manage to get one of those packs, you can actually collect one of those free gifts from our Next Steps desk. That's located in the foyer at the end of tonight's service. Well, we are continuing with the continent of Africa, so please put your hands together for our next lot of performers.
Shikilia. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Truly, the Spirit of God is in here. Ladies and gentlemen, we are Spirit of Africa, and we're going to be performing tonight. The song we're going to be performing is called Ichokwadimwari Aripo, which means it's true that the presence of the Lord and God is in our life. So when He calls on you, do answer, and God will do wonderful things. So give it up for Spirit of Africa. All right. All right, just get our acoustics going on, and then we'll be started fully. Facing a bit of technical difficulties with our acoustic guitar. Someone can help us out. Oh, we'll start. Ichokwadi. Ichokwadi.
Ichokwadi,
Ichokwadi,
Mariariko,
Ichokwadi,
Mariariko,
gentlemen, please put your hands together for Spirit of Africa. While on the continent of Africa, there are a number of families from different African nations that make up our church. And we're going to take this opportunity to highlight just one of those countries, and that is the Congo. Do you know the vast majority of the population of the Congo identifies itself as Christian? In fact, Christianity in the Democratic Republic of the Congo has a unique history to the rest of sub-Sahara Africa. Christianity's presence predates the Great Scramble for Africa when European powers sought to colonize the continent during the turn of the 19th century.
Rather than as a result of colonization, Christianity first arrived in the Kingdom of Congo in 1491, brought by Portuguese explorers. It was during that time a very influential man, Nzinga Mbemba Afonso, who was a provincial chief, became a convert to Christianity. In 1506, this same man became the Manikongo, or ruler of the entire region. He then embarked on a modernization campaign that involved taking the gospel message throughout the Kingdom of the Congo. It was at this time that much of the population converted to Christianity.
One of the great Congolese men who's a part of our church is a man named Lebenda. Would you please welcome him to the stage tonight?
Hey, mate. How you doing? Have a seat. Lebenda, I met you some months ago, having been introduced to you at church. You started coming here to church. And I wanted to just find out a little bit about your story, because it's quite an amazing story. You come from Congo. We'll talk about how you arrived in Australia, but how long has it been since you were living in Congo?
Sorry, I didn't understand your question, please.
When did you leave Congo? What year?
Okay. I leave Congo 2001.
2001, you left Congo?
Yes.
And you arrived in Australia the day after Christmas, 2013?
Yes, 26 December.
So, why did you leave Congo?
Okay, I left the Congo because in our country, because my English is not very strong. And let me tell you, I left the Congo because in my country, the war, the conflict between tribes and the politics. So there was a situation, it was very bad to kill people. So I left because I wanted to save my life and my family.
Now, you told me that when you were living in Congo, it was so unsafe that you would not sleep in your house. You would sleep...
Yes. When the conflict began, it was very difficult to sleep in your house. So, sometime in the forest. Yeah. And there, when the opposite of your tribe can go to you, and you must kill all of all family, to kill them, to cut a throat,
So your family is sleeping in the forest instead of your house.
Yes.
Tell us about your family at that stage. How many children?
I have 8 children, but 3 was born in Mozambique.
Okay.
Yeah.
So to get from Congo, you went from Congo to Tanzania?
Yes.
To escape the fighting?
Yeah, the boat.
In a boat. Tell us about that.
Yeah. From Congo, we left in the boat from Congo to Tanzania.
Now, is this a boat like you would get to Magnetic Island?
Yes, I think.
What, is this a big boat or a little boat?
No, it was a small boat. No, big.
How many people on the boat?
6 or 7.
6 or 7. So your family?
Yes, it was my family only.
During daytime or nighttime?
Nighttime.
Had you been in a boat before?
Yes.
How long did it take you to get across?
3 days.
When you were in Tanzania, you went to a refugee camp?
Yes.
And then you left that refugee camp, didn't you?
Yeah, I left it there, and from Tanzania to Mozambique.
Were you allowed to leave the refugee camp in Tanzania, or did you have to sneak away?
No, I didn't like to be there because it's very, very costly of my country. So I thought it's not very good to be there.
It was unsafe?
Yes.
Because the conflict in Congo
was
transferred to the refugee camp across the lake.
Yeah, of course.
So how long did it take you to get from Tanzania to Mozambique?
Mozambique, 3 days.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you were telling me that journey, you went on a bus, but if anybody knew that you were from the refugee camp, you would get sent back. Is that right?
Yeah, is it okay?
So you got to Mozambique?
From Tanzania, when we arrived at the border of Tanzania and Mozambique, there was nobody, no people there. Uh-huh. So we worked 3 days without food, water, and anything who can help us. 3 days in the forest. And we took matches because we must to put something about fire here, and fire there and here, and we must sleep in the middle because the lion can kill us.
So you eventually got to Mozambique, to the safety of another refugee camp in Mozambique?
Yes.
How long were you in that refugee camp?
Oh, 12 years.
12 years.
Yes.
What was that like?
Sorry?
What was it like? Describe the refugee camp.
Yeah, it was very bad there because sometimes we were there without the food, sometimes, and you know, in Mozambique is a country who is very poor. So it's poor, and as we are refugees, it was a very, very bad situation.
Now, some of your children were born in that camp?
In Mozambique, yes, 3 children.
So how many children total?
8.
8 children. So you, your wife, and 8 children.
Yes.
And in that refugee camp, 12 years, you became a pastor, a preacher.
Yes, of course.
Of course. Now, how did you get from there to Australia?
I went to tell my problem to the UNHCR. It's one organization who help the refugees. And I told them my situation. Mm-hmm. After that, he sent my case to Pretoria, the big office. And there...
You got to keep the microphone up.
Yeah, and there he sent my case to the immigration, immigration from here, Australia. And Australia went to see me in the camp and to interview me. So he accepted me to go here, to come here.
What did you know about Australia? Did you know anything about Australia?
No. I didn't know anything. So at school, geography, and history, I knew something about Australia, but I didn't know very more Australia.
Tell us about when you flew into Australia on Boxing Day last year. What was it like for you arriving in Australia? What did you feel?
Because when we arrived here, it was very hot. Then hot, then Mozambique. But Mozambique is hot, but here is very, very hot.
So you're resettled in Townsville, and in Townsville there is help for refugees to help you with a house and so forth.
Sorry?
How did you end up at Calvary Church?
My friend, Adrian.
Adrian, yeah.
Adrian, yes. He told me about this church. Uh-huh. So now I'm here.
So you and your wife and your 8 children have been coming to church here now for maybe 6 months?
No, now I think Yes, I think so, six months.
And do you like the church?
Very good and very nice.
Do you like the pastor?
Oh, I like a pastor, yes. I must to like a pastor.
Now, some of your boys are going to sing for us, is that right?
Yes.
Can you tell us what they're going to do?
He will singing about ukombozi. Ukombozi, it means someone who can, I don't know very well what word I can. Can you help me? Savior, yes.
They sing about the Savior,
yes.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, are you singing too or just the boys?
No, so boys and the daughters.
Oh, okay, so five of your children,
I think,
are going to sing. Yeah. Well, would you give Lubenda's a great welcome and his children as they sing for us tonight? I love you. Thank you.
Sorry for my English.
No, it's
thank you.
gentlemen, that was the wonderful Bahekelwa family. Thank you.
Fantastic. Why don't you put your hands together one more time for the Congolese family. We're now going to leave the continent of Africa and travel to the Polynesian Islands, beginning first of all with Samoa. Religion is one of the most important aspects of Samoan culture, to the extent that it's incorporated into Samoa's motto, Samoa is founded on God.
Like many of the other Pacific Islands, it was early contact with the church that introduced Samoans to Europeans and to the West. Prior to the arrival of the missionaries, Samoa had a complex polytheistic religion which incorporated ancestor worship.
The Samoan religion, however, contained in it the seeds of its own destruction because the war goddess Nafanu had prophesied that there would come a new religion which would end the rule of the old gods. This prophecy perfectly prepared Samoa for the coming good news of the gospel about the Lord Jesus Christ.
The arrival of new churches has continued in a steady stream through to the present day, and church attendance is very high.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Samoa.
Talo falava. Paman. Fatalo fatu yai, ngom fain fata simani afiafi. Manuel was fana sheni. Talo falava and welcome to the island of Samoa. Sawia!
Thank you.
milli. Patia. No party. Tatufa.
Nobody wanna see you rising, and when they do, they don't even like it. They just wanna see you deep in crisis. Drive yourself, you don't need the license. Holla her, she can even ride it. Go ahead, move your feet just like this. Then he showed me the latest. We walk over them haters. Now what you do, man, ya zoom to, zoom to, zoom to. Now watch me do my zonto, azonto, azonto. Now watch me do my zonto, azonto, azonto. Now watch me do my zonto, azonto. We walk over the places. Now watch you do my zonto, zonto, zonto.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Samoa. Led there by the Tupawola family, doing some very traditional Samoan dancing. We're now going to head to the Polynesian island of Fiji.
Christianity came to Fiji in 1835 via the Pacific island of Tonga, who displayed a greater receptiveness to the European newcomers. One of the earliest missionaries, John Hunt, arrived to a nation of ferocious cannibals and fierce warriors embroiled in destructive tribal warfare.
Fiji became a British colony in 1874 and saw Christianity's more predominant role within the Fijian society develop, as the old religion was gradually replaced by the new Christian faith. Most influential were the Methodist denomination, which is still the predominant denomination today in Fiji.
In post-coup Fiji, the Methodist Church, which is as close to an official religion as Fiji has gained considerably more influence.
In Fiji, there's a church or denomination for just about everyone. Visitors are always welcome to a Fijian service and participate in one of the many village services. The Fijian church is a wonderful experience. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Fiji.
Oh,
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Fiji. Well, from Fiji, we're going to come a little closer to home. Please put your hands together for the Torres Strait Islands.
Good evening. Before we begin, we would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of this land upon which we meet, the Walgurukuba and Bindal people. Thank you. We have different variations of dance. As you can see, we're standing up. This time we're going to do a dance on the ground, sitting down. This next song is called Taba Nava, and it's about going out fishing on the reef.
Gentlemen, please put your hands together for the Torres Strait Islands. And in particular, our two youngest performers, Lily and Arabella. Would you put your hands together for those two little girls? Well, we're now about to head to Papua New Guinea.
The first mission in Eastern New Guinea was the London Missionary Society, which in 1871 set up mission teachers from the Loyalty Islands on islands adjacent to and on the Papuan mainland. Some New Guineans resisted the changes missionaries represented, while others accepted opportunities for new forms of wealth, power, and age and gender relations.
It was in 1948 that the first Assemblies of God missionaries from Australia established a mission in Papua New Guinea, in Mutpurik, in the East Sepik district. Today, the Pentecostal Church in PNG has spread across the country and is twice the size of its parent body in Australia. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please put your hands together for PNG?
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Papua New Guinea. Well, that brings us tonight to our final country, which is India. Now, India has a history of great religious tolerance, which is born out of the incredible breadth of religious expression in the nation of India.
With 80% of India's population practicing Hindus, Hinduism is the most dominant religion. Islam is second with 13% Muslim population. Official Indian statistics claim that Christians represent a small number.
However, C. Peter Wagner in 2012 showed a study with significant growth in the evangelical Christianity of India. Evidenced by statistics provided by pastors across India, Wagner puts current Christian numbers in India at 140 million people, about 10% of the country. This would make India the fastest area of gospel growth on the planet, even exceeding China. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for India. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for India. The Indian folk are a part of our church, are a great part of our church, and there seem to be more and more Indians who keep on becoming part of our church, thanks to one of our dancers who was just on stage, Thomas Manampanampan, who is one of the legends of our church. Two other a great young couple who's a part of our church who just performed is a young couple, Satish and Joyce. Would you please welcome them back to the stage tonight?
Hey, mate. How you doing? Hey, Joyce.
Hello.
Good to see you. Come have a seat. You guys have quite an amazing story, but before we get to your story, because it's a miracle that you're actually here and alive.
Yes.
But before we get to that, you live in Ayr, yep, managing McDonald's, is that right?
Yeah.
But you come to Calvary Church every Sunday.
That's right.
So how did all that happen?
We're actually from Melbourne. So from India, we went to Melbourne. Straight away, we had been there for five and a half years, pretty much. Mm-hmm. And then James here was the guest pastor to a bridge church over there. And since then, we fell in with love with you and the church. Well, in a positive sense. And then once we moved here for some visa reasons, and that's when Joyce actually Googled it. We missed your name, so we couldn't recall it, but your picture is in our mind. So we started looking at the pictures and everything, and that's when we decided, okay, this is where we want to go.
I didn't know that, but that's such a great story.
It is.
So you've been coming to Calvary Church. You grew up as a Hindu, in a Hindu family,
yeah,
is that right?
I was born as a Hindu, mm-hmm. Yes.
And your father became a Christian. Tell us how your father came to Christ.
He was a non-believer. He's got 11 kids altogether. Like he and my. So one day, he always had this question before going to Indian idols. And he used to pray saying this. Hindu holy book is written in Sanskrit. It's one of the ancient religion. And he started to pray this prayer that says, I don't know to figure out which God is true in all these idols.
Because there are millions of gods
millions,
in Hinduism, isn't there?
There are millions.
Yeah.
So my mom is a great devotee too. She used to be the first person in our street to worship idols and to invite people to just gather because that's how the culture is. So my father used to pray, whoever God it is, I ask you to bless me and please reveal yourself to me. So he's been a very rich man in India, in our state, in my place. So there's been these financial breakdowns and stuff, troubles. But this is what he said at the time. He said, I always had this puzzle in my mind. So this is a great time, I believe, to search for God, whoever it is. And he said, whether it's a Hindu, Christian, or Muslims, most of us, we might be born religious people, but we never read the holy books of religion when we are born in that. It usually happens. So I want to go into this. I want to do a research and see whoever it is, whoever the God is, and I want to come to a conclusion. So he did it. I want to mark this. We did not come to God, or he did not come to God just because there were financial ups and downs. No. He took that time because we used to not see him for 6 to 7 months nearly when he was busy. He took his time and then he came to a conclusion, Jesus is the true God. Mm-hmm. So he told us, what I want you to do is, he called me and my brother and my mom too. He's a very good communicator. He told us, I want you to research. I challenge you to research. My mom is not that educated person, so usually she believes what my dad believes. But because she's a very strong Hindu devotee, she should not come to God straight away. So my dad said, my brother challenged my dad. He said, why do we have to go for this? Why do we have to choose this? Didn't our ancestors die peacefully? Why do we have to choose this? So my dad said only this. He said, well, you investigate. I can't say this in words, you investigate. And that's how we investigated. So because Hinduism is a vast religion, it's an ancient religion. It's written in Sanskrit, and my mother tongue is close to Sanskrit, but it's hard to understand Sanskrit. So I went to the scholars. I went to the scholars who's chosen Christianity as their way. And I've called them, I've asked them to send the books written in my language so that I can understand what's it in it. So there's a sloka in Sanskrit which actually says about Jesus. It says there should be a bloodshed. There should be a bloodshed for the redemption of human sins. And it should not be some animals, but the holy persons, and that should be God. And as everyone knows, I've got Muslim friends too, as everyone knows, Quran says about Jesus. So obviously, Bible is full of Jesus. So I started reading it, and I came to a conclusion too. So Jesus is true.
Now, how old were you when you gave your life to Jesus?
1998 in June. I think I was doing I finished my 10th grade.
10th grade.
10th grade.
Now, subsequent to that, you got very ill, is that right?
That's right. So since then, as I told, our financial situations, our financial troubles did not subside, but it's been more worse than that. But we believe that God gave us enough strength to deal with that stuff. So we were ready. We were ready to say, God, come on, pour it on. Give us anything. We're ready to face it. And then in 2007, in April, so miraculously after all these years, we've come out of these financial troubles, and we're pretty much like we're back to normal. And then in July, I was planning for my business. I've resigned for 7 months. And then I've decided, okay, I have to do my own business. And then after 7 months of my hard work, I've got a call from the company saying that if you be consistent in your work for a week, we would say go. So I was so stubborn, I was so hard, I was been working so hard. And the next day, I couldn't stand up. Because I was so much into starting the business, I've told my parents, I was so reluctant to go to the hospital too. I've told my parents, okay, I don't want to go to the hospital. So for today, I'm totally like a vegetable.
So for four days, you can't stand up?
No, on my first day, I couldn't walk. Uh-huh. Like my hands were, my legs were, there's no pain, but I couldn't stand up. Uh-huh. I don't know what it is. So I thought it's usually from the workouts and stuff. And it came to fourth day where my cousin came and said, no, you know, he's not able to urinate on his own. This is not good. So they took me to the hospital, and that's when doctor said, you're 97% gone. So there's only 3% chance for you to live because your immune system is down. Everything is against you. He even said that one of the American presidents who served the American nation in a wheelchair, the only American, Franklin Roosevelt, has passed away because of this syndrome.
So you were diagnosed with motor neurons disease, is that right?
It's Guillain-Barré's syndrome.
Okay.
Guillain-Barré syndrome. So it's a neurological disorder. So even if I live, he said that I cannot assure you that you can walk back again. So miraculously, when I was in the hospital, then this pastor came in, and my church pastor over there, he was in America, and he called and said, because God speaks, if God is true. So he spoke to the pastor and said, no, Satish is not going to die. And he called my parents and said, Satish is not going to die. He's going to testify about God. And that's when my cousin is a pastor too, cousins farly related. So he came and he believed in that, and he said, word is true, prophecy is true. So we have to. When on the first day, when doctor said, you've got only 3 days time and you've got only 3% to live, chances to live, he said, we will take photos because in future you're going to testify about God.
So we're looking at that photo now of when you were very ill.
I'm younger now. I look more younger now, I can say that.
Yeah, you look like an old man.
I know that.
So what happened?
So miraculously on third day, doctor, he's an atheist doctor. Mm. He doesn't believe God, and he made my parents to sign the documents to saying that if I pass away, because he said that usually it happens to 1 in 1,000,000. So fortunately, unfortunately, there was one person who was admitted before you, but he got only till legs and he hit the lungs. So when we put a person on the ventilator, so that's a sign saying that he'll be no more. So for me, until here, I can only move my head, but not my whole body till here. So everything I'm doing on bed itself. And so he made it to sign, and third day he came and said, Satish, I can now believe, you know, whatever God you believe in, you because there are nearly 3,000 people who attended the hospital, the Christian believers and people who believe in love. So whoever you believe in or whatever prayers you do, you're alive enough, but there's a more challenge for you. You can't walk. It's hard. You're like a kid and you have to work it out. So from there I started and now here I am. Praise God. Thank God.
That's a great thing. Very good. Very good. Now, the rest of your family, they're back in India?
Back in India. Everyone came to
Christ. And are they all following Jesus?
Yes, they're all following Jesus.
That's an amazing thing.
It's only our family and our community because in India, as everyone knows, it's divided into religions,
yeah,
castes, and different regions. So we belong to a higher community in India, in my place. So not many people believe in this God, but no one dared to ask my dad because he's a rich bloke at the time. Yeah, that's a good sign for us.
So you're following Jesus, and in the cricket you follow?
No one.
You're a politician.
No, I don't follow cricket. Tennis, I love tennis, yeah. I like Sachin, usually, yeah.
We're so glad you're part of our church.
My pleasure.
I would encourage everybody, next time you're driving through Ayr, stop at Macca's,
yep,
and buy up big.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Hey, give these guys a round of applause.
Thank
good
you.
To
God bless you
guys.
Thank you.
Bless you. You know, one of the reasons we do nights like tonight is because the world in which we live is incredibly troubled. You switch on the television news, you open a newspaper, and you see that the world is just being torn apart with sectarian strife and ethnic division, and yet the Church of Jesus, I believe, is a miracle. The Church of Jesus, where you've got people from all different nations and tribes speaking different languages with different cultural traditions, and yet are able to live in harmony and unison together, not simply because we're nice people, many of us weren't, but because of one person who's changed all of our lives, and that's the person of Jesus Christ. And for us at Calvary, it is an incredibly important thing, I believe, to be able to have a church in a multi-ethnic city where we can demonstrate to the city that it is very possible for people of different backgrounds and cultures and come from different places to yet, whilst keeping their distinctives, unite together around a common cause that hopefully causes us all to be better people. And of course, that's the person of Jesus, who to me is a miracle. I mean, think about it. Jesus is born in the most obscure place in the Middle East. He never writes a book. He never travels more than about 300 kilometers from the place of his birth, and he's dead by age 33. And yet, he said that he would turn the world upside down and change it forever with just 12 men who witnessed not just his death, but also his resurrection from the grave. And those 12 uneducated, unlearned men, equipped with a simple message: for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so whoever believes in him would not perish but would have eternal life. With that message, they literally changed the world. The apostle John had a great vision where he said, I saw people from every nation, every tribe, every tongue worshiping together. And it's all around that simple message: for God so loved the world. You know what I love about that? It says to me that Christianity is not the initiative of men, but it's the initiative of God. It's not because we loved God, but because God loved us. How many of you know that means it's not because of anything we've done, therefore we've got nothing to boast about or to be proud about or arrogant concerning? It wasn't that we loved him, it was that he loved us. That's an amazing thing. For God so loved the world. You know, the truth is God is not Australian or American or Asian or African, and yet every culture in the world has aspects that reflect the magnificence, the creativity, the glory, and the color of God. And God didn't come for a particular people group, but God came for the whole world. It doesn't matter who you are, where you've been, or what you've done. It doesn't matter where you're from. God loves every single person. For God so loved, it was his initiative, the world. And then the Bible says that he gave his only son, which to me is the distinctive thing about the Christian faith. It's a faith of generosity, firstly of the generosity of God toward humanity. And I think when you've got a faith where the emphasis is on the fact, not that we loved God, but that God loved us, not that we did a lot of good things, but that God himself was generous toward us. And so Jesus said, freely we've received, and so freely we should give. And so the distinctive of the Christian faith ought to be, if we're following Jesus Christ, an incredible overflow of generosity toward our common man. Not because they deserve it, not because they've earned it, not because they have merited it, for none of us deserved or earned or merited the love of God toward us, and yet he loved us anyway. And so having freely received the generous gift of forgiveness and love and mercy in Jesus, we then are called to convey that same love, mercy, compassion, understanding to our common man, regardless of who he is, where he's from, or what he's like. How many of you know that message has the power to unify the world and bring people together? It says, for God so loved the world. It was his initiative for everybody that he gave his only son. And then it says, so whosoever, I love that word, whosoever. Not for good people or bad people, not for rich people or poor people, not for people from that country or that part of the world, but whosoever would believe. Which means that whoever you are, whatever your socioeconomic background, anybody can believe. It's not what we do, it's just taking a small step of faith to acknowledge there is a God who created all the nations of the world, that they might reach out and perhaps find him. And if we would just, as was described so brilliantly a moment ago, believe in the person of Jesus, then anybody, no matter who they are, where they've been or what they've done, can know the love of God in their own heart. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son so that whoever believes in him, and then it concludes with this line, would not perish but would have eternal life. You know, the Christian message is all about giving people life. One of the things I've observed tonight is that people have come to faith in Christ and yet they've not become uniform in their expression of it. We come to Jesus and yet we're still the unique individuals that he created us to be. We still retain our cultural traditions and heritage, but what Jesus does rather than suppressing us is rather he brings out who we were always supposed to be and enhances our life so that it's full and expressive and prosperous. And I think it's a wonderful message. God didn't come to squash or contain people, but rather he created every person unique, distinct, special. And when Jesus comes into our heart and we escape guilt and shame and our sin, all of a sudden we're empowered to be the kind of people we know deep down we were always supposed to be. And so if you're new to Calvary Church, that's the message of our church. Not that anyone has to be like anything in particular, but rather that God so loved every single person that he gave of himself. And if we would just put our faith not in ourselves, but in him and his love, then we would find that the life we were created to live would start to blossom and prosper, and we could be all God created us to be. And so whether this is your first time in church or whether you've been to church many, many times, our prayer for every person tonight is that you would know the love of Jesus in your life and that Jesus would help you to be all that he created you to be with your unique and special giftings, talents, temperaments, so that the society and the community in which we live would be better and would be more blessed because you were able to be the fullness of all God intended for you to be. As we conclude tonight, we've got one more special performance. Then we're going to partake of food from all around the world. But I want to pray tonight that no matter who you are or where you've been or what you've done, that Jesus would make himself real to you. Why don't we pray? Heavenly Father, I thank you tonight that you love every single person. No matter our sexual orientation, no matter our ethnic background, no matter our religious background, every person is created by you and greatly loved. You loved us so much that you died for our sin and our mistakes, so that if we freely look to you, we might receive as your gift love, forgiveness, a hope and a great future. Father, we're so in awe of your gift. I pray that every person here tonight would understand how greatly loved they are of God. And as we put our faith in you, that you might transform us more and more into your image, that we would be the people you created us to be, that our city would be blessed, and that people might live in peace and harmony. And we ask it all in the wonderful name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Thanks, Dan.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for our senior pastors, Pastor James and Samantha McPherson. Well, on behalf of Pastor James and Sam, along with Miriam and myself, it has been an absolute pleasure tonight to be able to host you as a part of our annual International Night. In a moment's time, we're about to head outside where there is...
lots of food.
There is lots of food. In fact, the taste of the world outside. And so you can, when you head outside, you'll see the host team can direct you. There are lines either side that you can collect your food from. We'd also like to remind people that we're going to keep the decking for our seniors and those who are physically challenged, and keep those seats there. There's also lots of other areas where you can go and get food. We also want to remind mums and dads, if you could please go and collect your children from the children's program prior to heading outside and collecting food. Once you've collected your kids and head outside, you'll see that there is a kids barbecue, an Aussie barbecue, and some jumping castles out there as well. But we'd love to take this opportunity to thank some very special people.
We just want to appreciate the dignitaries who took their time out of their busy schedule to actually come and be with us. Thank you very much. Can we just give a clap to them? We also want to take this time to say thank you to each one of you for taking the time to come to this event. Without you, we wouldn't have had to do a performance. So I just want you to turn to the person on your right and on your left and just tell them, thank you for coming, and please come next year.
If you could also put your hands together for a whole team of production people who have helped us put tonight on. And for those who've cooked food today that we're about to enjoy, put your hands together for them. And then finally, all of our many performers, many of whom have spent weeks and months practicing ready for tonight, would you please put your hands together for all of our performers? Well, as the final act of tonight, we have our final act, and it is an Indian act. It is a love story, a Bollywood love story told between two young men, one using his contemporary tunes and the other using traditional Bollywood tunes to charm the one girl. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please put your hands together for our final Indian act tonight and the finale? This is India.
तुझे देखा तो ये जाना सनम प्यार होता है दीवाना सनम तुझे देखा तो ये जाना सनम
100 years old.
Ladies and gentlemen, this has been our international night brought to you by all of our performers and our church. Please put your hands together for all of our performers. Please enjoy the taste of the world outside. Remember to collect your children. Thank you very much, and we'll see you next Sunday.
If these ashes came from flames, and if we relight these embers, would they just burn out again? We can try, we should try.